You know, the interesting thing with as with this generation and as video games continue to improve.
Video games.
Did you see that quote from Amy Hennig?
Yes, I did.
You know, it's stating the obvious, isn't it?
What is the quote, Willie?
The quote is, let me just pull this up here. From Amy Hennig, a.k.a. former creative director of Naughty Dog and
writer of the Legacy of Kain games and Uncharted series.
Yes.
Which is the best writing resume in the business.
people,
no, wait, Avalon.
So, in general, it was just talking about the genre and saying people asking for linear story-based games but aren't necessarily buying them. But the quote then goes into like kind of talk about the trends in video games right now as a whole. And she says, I think we're at an inflection point right now. Obviously, what happened with our Star Wars project didn't come out of the blue. A lot of too dramatic articles were written about it, the death of linear story games and all that kind of stuff. But look, there's a real problem. This line we've been running up to for a lot of years, which is the rising cost of development and the desires or demands even of players in terms of hours of gameplay, fidelity, production values, additional modes, and all these things. Those pressures end up very real internally. If it costs you, say, $100 million or more to make a game, how are you going to make that money back and make a profit? The $60 price point can't change, right? So there's a lot of negative press around monetization, loot boxes, games as a service, etc. But these are trending now in the industry, especially for larger publishers, as an answer to the problem of rising development costs. Budgets keep going up, and the bars keep getting raised, and it starts making less and less sense to make these games. There's also a trend now that, as much as people will protest and say, why are you canceling a linear story-based game? This is the kind of game we want. People aren't necessarily buying them. They're watching somebody else play them online.
So this is the kind of thing that if I wanted to be a real cunt about it, I could just tersely and dismissively say citation needed.
Sure.
But I will go into that more. So I completely understand where Amy Hennig is coming on this. She has worked on these types of games for a long, long, long fucking time. Legacy of Kain would have been fucking ruined by today's
standard
of YouTube and Twitch coverage,
mm-hmm.
right? Because a lot of those games are bad except for the awesome story.
Mm-hmm.
However, the big point here is, one, budgets keep rising. We got to do something. And people are just playing and watching story-based games online.
Citation needed on that bold sentence
so,
at the end.
So the first one, budgets keep rising, like nobody told you to do that. Like, yes, gamers will generally buy the shinier, fancier one. But like, look at fucking Stardew Valley. It's like the fourth most popular game on the Switch.
Certainly. But, you know, people like you are still hitting up Digital Foundry on the regular.
Yeah, but that's for performance.
But well, no, I'm trying to get at the idea that, like, you know, 1080 60
yeah
is a raw demand.
Yeah.
And beyond that, then you're getting into like the larger, more ridiculous like assets and larger, more ridiculous expensive world building you know, games we've seen and things like that. There is a demand that games keep up the level of like photorealism that they've been heading towards.
But
we can't pretend that doesn't exist.
I think there is absolutely a segment of the market that just goes, oh, it's the shiniest, newest, nicest looking thing. I think the amount of people that buy games that would just appreciate a good game, whether or not it was bleeding edge, is dramatically understated. PUBG looks like shit.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. MOBAs look like fucking trash, and they're the most popular games in the world. Look at Undertale or Stardew Valley or any of these fucking indie games that go on to sell way more than they're supposed to be able to, and they're made dirt cheap in a lot of cases. Like, EA spent so much money making the Battlefront assets so good, but then they got to make the microtransactions to make the money back because of all the money with it. It's like, well, why didn't you just make the game look a little less crazy and just put out a regular game that didn't blow up in a PR shitstorm and then lose you a bunch of money on a Star Wars game? Well, because then we could have made infinite money, but then we didn't.
So remember Watch Dogs?
I do remember Watch Dogs.
Remember how they showed you one thing?
Yes, and then they showed you the other. Yes, mm-hmm. I do.
I remember how that went.
Yes.
Hey, here's pretty bad.
Here's a pro tip.
Don't show something
Don't
else.
Show the shit that's not real.
Don't show the other
The
thing.
Worst one ever, and it's not the worst one ever because of, like, the graphical fidelity.
Yeah.
But BioShock Infinite's fucking reveal trailer is purported to be gameplay, and not a single mechanic, gameplay experience, level, or situation in that entire, like, 10-minute trailer is in the game.
You grab onto the hook and you do the hook thing.
Okay, sorry. That one's in. But the part where Elizabeth fucking gives you a big fucking shrapnel ball,
yeah,
the one where you walk in, where you walk around and things are phasing in and out, and you don't, mm-hmm. like, it's that's
the crow
crap.
Attack. The crow attack is there, and then there's
but it's not used the same way.
Yeah.
I remember
when we got into that whole thing, because I was like, I see how this is, like, way different in execution, but they kept the same puzzle pieces.
The little piece that drives me super nuts is, I remember Jeff Gerstmann interviewing Ken Levine about that thing. And he's like, "What? Yeah, man, that part where he throws the horse, that's crazy. Was that tough?" He's like, "Oh, man, it took our animator so long to have the handyman throw the horse. It was so hard. Oh, I can't wait to see that in the game." Like, fuck
so
you, Ken.
I honestly, every time the BioShock Infinite thing comes up, I automatically just go, like, Killzone was way worse. Why are we talking about this? That's the worst.
Okay, Bunny Hawk. Okay, if you want a really in-depth breakdown of the legal shenanigans about what we're talking about right now, go look at Super Bunny Hop's channel, and there's a video that he's got about false advertising in games that goes into this, and he talks about Killzone.
Yep.
And the reason why I don't feel Killzone is as bad is because I feel you'd have to be an idiot to think that was actually
But that's crazy. You know what I mean? Like, I know what you mean
because it's so obvious.
Because
it's so clearly a CG trailer.
But it's not what they were putting out
it's
there.
It's more brazen, for sure.
It's balls fucking out is what they're doing
there. But I find
there.
The Insidious... Jim Sterling did a really good video on the way Ubisoft often does it. Not with graphics, though they do that all the time. But they do it with fucking the fake friend chatter.
Sure.
In the live demo, that's annoying. The least real thing
that's
ever,
really
but
bad.
Makes it feel all tactical and cool.
But here's the thing: is in a world where we've seen, like, 8 different versions of Agni's philosophy.
Yes.
Right. Like, we know that, like, well, I mean, and well, it's a long distance between Killzone and that. But either way, the idea of being more brazen and therefore being able to get away with it, to me, is no.
Well, here's the thing. Sony never got away with it. Everybody knew right away. I was like, it's fucking fake shit.
My point is just that that's the all-time worst to me, right? And I can't look at something like BioShock.
I bring up BioShock Infinite and you bring up Killzone, and those are both really bad, but the all-time worst is Alien Colonial Marines. I just remembered that just now. Like, that is bordering on criminal. In fact, no, it actually is criminal.
It was.
So I disagree with that statement just philosophically.
Sure.
But the last one.
No Man's Sky, anybody?
Yeah. Apparently that game's good now. Because they've updated. Like, isn't that crazy?
Sure.
They should have waited. Maybe.
That makes sense.
But the last one where it's like people aren't buying these games. They're just watching them online. So everything I'm going to say is anecdotal, but that's horse shit. The amount of people we have personally run into in which our Let's Plays, which ostensibly, or our Let's Plays or streams, which are ostensibly the thing that kills sales, have resulted in people going, "Oh, I didn't know about Yakuza, JoJo, this, that, fighting game of whatever. And I bought it because I liked your coverage of it or whatever," is astronomical. Every single time I ever mm-hmm. talk to somebody who watches this channel or my streams or Wooly Versus or Matt's stuff, they go, "I didn't know about the thing that they said because marketing sucks, and now I bought it."
I agree with you in part because I have to.
Well, it's the nature of our work.
But also... you do. It's incredibly anecdotal.
Yes. What's less anecdotal?
That is super duper based on our personal experience.
What's less anecdotal is that when the Persona 5 kerfuffle came out, Twitch came out because they have metrics mm-hmm. on what people buy through the Amazon page. Mm-hmm. Where like tons of people purchase games after watching streams.
Yeah,
tons of people.
I mean, it would be
like thousands and thousands.
It would be awesome to see the numbers on how many people watch our stuff and go out and get a thing versus the number that watch our stuff in replacement for that, for getting that thing.
But here's
we'll never know. Yeah, well, it's impossible.
Well, you could get that data, but there is one data point on that that you'll never get is would they have purchased it if that option was
available.
Now we're into the piracy argument. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Is a pirated copy a lost sale? Well, no, not if the person's wretchedly poor. No, it's not.
So that and it, now you're getting exactly you're getting into metrics that like involve like way too many dynamics that you can't peg down.
That being said, you know? My personal and your personal anecdotal evidence says not only is that nonsense, it's reversed. And the rough data, the only rough data that currently exists, also says that it is the reverse of that. That LPs and streams are like primarily forms of super intense targeted marketing.
If I'm going on, and again, extremely anecdotal, just what people say to us all the time, very rarely do people say, I'm glad I'm watching this. I was gonna buy it, but instead I'll just watch you do it.
I've never had that. Some person.
I've seen that happen.
I've seen it,
but it's nowhere near as often as oh shit, I gotta pick this up.
Well, you know,
now.
You know what the single most popular comment on every single one of our LPs is after you guys suck. After that one, that's the most popular.
Yeah, of course.
But the second one is fuck. They're playing this new game. I got it, or I was gonna get it.
Yeah.
Now I can't watch their stuff for a month.
Yeah. That comes in. And occasionally there's, oh, man, I guess I got to go grab it and catch up, right? Like
the number one, it's like, it happened with Dark Souls. It happened with anything that we go slow on.
The race
like
off Bully. Of Taris.
It's like, nah, fuck this. I'm going to buy the game. I want to
see it. Impatience, you know? But either way, that's a real thing. And, like, people have totally told us about each one of these instances where they'd go up and pick it up. So I can see how from Amy's point of view, not being we're in the position that we are to get that data, it seems like bullshit. Our games are online in video form. That shit sucks. You're stealing sales. But it all evidence appears to from our POV point otherwise.
And I would say that part of that point
anecdotal as fuck.
Yeah, a part of the point of view that I would give Amy and like why I understand where she's coming from. She writes for games like they're movies. And if you just said, hey, everyone, come see my movie for free. Fuck.
Sure.
that sucks.
Sure.
Because Amy writes linear narratives. Mm-hmm. She has super, super good linear narratives, but they're basically films. Like you take all the gameplay out of an Uncharted game.
Yeah,
you get a miniseries essentially,
and I mean it definitely depends on the genre as well. Like a fighting game is all about pretty much watching it and going, oh fuck, and then I gotta go pick it up.
It's
you can't possibly have the experience you're watching. A linear story, definitely is the least.
It has the most potential to be damaged by this.
Yes, exactly. I'll put it that way.
I totally agree with her. If there is a loss of sales to games, I would say that it is only towards games that are primarily about their story.
Because of the replay value slash the individual the individual playthrough is pretty much identical for most people.
Yeah. Also, let me change that slightly. There is one scenario in which Twitch streams, review content, and LPs and all that stuff do hurt sales of the game. And it's when the game is trash. when the game sucks and everybody knows it, that is bad for your business.
Well, you say that, but here's the thing. Remember the years of when are you going to do Omicron and then we didn't do it for so long?
Yeah.
No one was touching Omicron.
No.
And then they made it free for a bit and then that got a couple curious people on board. But now people are regularly sending a screenshot going, holy fuck, how did you do this? Mm-hmm. I can't believe it. I'm trying it for myself. This is impossible.
I would say that is something of a fringe case.
But those spite sales existed as opposed to no sales because it wasn't on the radar.
I would specifically instead refer to a different David Cage game.
A newer game.
Such as a new one.
Yeah.
Like Beyond Two Souls.
Yeah. Where
Like, yes. This, like...
The new trash.
We like new trash.
The new trash.
We like
absolutely
to stand on our moral high ground and be like, we're helping developers out by showcasing their good games. Also, we make a little money. But when it came to the Heavy Rain and Beyond Two Souls and soon to be Detroit, like, we have taken the... I think those are the only games we've done this with. Like, of the opposite stance of like, we are playing this so you don't have to because this game sucks. Don't buy it.
Yeah, when something is new, then for sure you're 100% chipping away at that because people are just going like,
well, there have been fighters that came out, there have been shooters that came out. It's like, oh, a guy got it. Oh, a guy's streaming it a couple days. Oh, it sucks.
Fucking Bubsy. That's any Sonic games, like, you know what I mean? Like, yeah, for sure.
You don't need coverage for that, you know.
But you know, it ends up being that ends up being definitely something that hurts. But it's also like the sales you would have gotten are the same as like confused parent marketing sales,
yeah,
or like font similarity sales where the person picked it up not knowing what was about to happen in a way. And it's like, yeah, well, you got their money. Congratulations. They're not happy with the product, but you got their money. And if it's on Steam, they might return it.
Maybe.
If it's a GameStop, they're definitely returning it. Mm-hmm. You know, so... Pff.